Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Let's have a discussion for the date 30th of August 2018. Today in our discussion, we are going to deal with four topics. Today's first topic is about environmental assessment. The redevelopment projects of Delhi have been in the news for quite some time, but these projects have been met with legal tangles. Why? Environmental impact assessment associated with these projects have not been conducted properly. That is why these projects met with legal tangles. But we will understand what is environmental impact assessment. These are reports that are very critical component of India's environmental decision making process. To start any project, we must conduct environmental impact assessment because they are detailed study of potential impacts of proposed projects. What will be the impacts if these projects getting implemented? Based on these reports, Environmental Ministry and other relevant regulatory bodies may grant approval, may not grant approval. So these environmental impact assessment reports are very essential, very important to define measures that the project could take in order to contain or offset the project impacts. Since this environmental impact assessment is very much important, it's very much critical to start a project, this should be based on scientific study. This should not be biased. So the law mandates that independent environmental impact assessment consultant to undertake this study. Let's now understand why Delhi's redevelopmental projects have met with legal tangles, because these projects used environmental impact assessment reports which are not conducted properly. How they have done? For example, we will have a case study. The consultant for the Nauroji Nagar project has used material from copyrighted papers, web pages and other environmental impact assessment reports. That means that they have not conducted environmental impact study for this particular project separately. They have used environmental impact assessment reports of other projects which have already been conducted, and they have just shown for this project. They have shown that water quality study was undertaken in 2015, 1 year before the project was commissioned. This report cites 8 water quality monitoring stations that are located for Nauroji Nagar project, but these 8 locations actually located in Tamil Nadu. This shows that there is no proper conduction of environmental impact study for every project separately, but they are mixing up with reports. They are using copyrighted papers, web pages and other reports. This malpractice continues to happen because Environmental Ministry's failure to come down heavily on this. In the end, it is the citizens who are bearing the brunt. There are many instances in which there is a missing information or misleading information. What Environmental Impact Assessment Notification 2000 says about this? It says that deliberate concealment or submission of false or misleading information or data can lead to rejection of the application or cancellation of the approval. That means that this notification wants every project to be initiated only after conducting proper environmental impact study. But ministries are continued to approve the projects which even not conducted proper environmental impact study, because it would mean stopping the projects of more powerful Ministry of Urban Development. Public hearings is one of the component of environmental impact study, but in most of the studies, this particular component is not given importance. Sometimes they ignore this, so the outcome will not be as much as expected. The world is facing a lot of environmental challenges, so experts are suggesting that public hearings should be given more importance and participation of public should be given importance in conduction of environmental impact study, but we are not giving much importance to this. It is very much disappointing that the government has generously exempted real estate projects from holding consultations with public. Since Delhi's redevelopmental projects were also approved without public consultations, so the public came forward and they put a lot of litigations. The actions of citizens and litigation has forced the project proponents and Ministry of Urban Development to state that they will revise the plans and to reduce and prevent tree felling. Today's second topic is power play on troubles of power sector. The RBI decided on February 12th of this year, it requires banks to complete insolvency resolution proceedings within 180 days of defaults. Across the banking system, about 70 firms with loans of around 3.8 lakh crore outstanding were expected to face the insolvency proceedings. This is fine. The news is about the next line. That is, 34 out of 70 firms are troubled accounts that are from the power sector alone. They constitute nearly 54%, that is around 2 lakh crore of banks' exposure to these cases. Why power sector alone constituting this much? The first one is fuel shortage due to cancellation of coal block allotments or lack of supply linkages. The second one is absence of power purchase agreements signed by state distribution companies. And third one is cost overruns due to delayed clearances. None of these factors are caused by power producers. These are external factors which caused this problem. So these power producers want some exemption. Several bankers and even the government have expressed reservations about the RBI directive in the month of February. Credible resolution plan may be difficult to construct unless key structural issues such as fuel supply and state distribution companies' financial woes are fixed. That means that we are aware of the fact that power sector is facing huge problem with respect to insolvency. And if you go for credible resolution plan, it is very difficult for power sector compared to other sectors. So the banks, so the government wants RBI to give some exemption to this sector. The problems faced by power sector is not new. This sector has been facing some of these issues since UPA government second term. Through coal block allotments and Uday scheme, this particular government have done something to deal with the issue. But the utilization rate of power plant capacities has been stagnant for quite some time at around 60% only. Since power sector is facing huge problem, power producers are seeking relief from RBI order to banks to recognize stressed loan if their repayments were missed by even a single day. But the Allahabad High Court dismissed this plea made by power producers. High Court refused to disturb RBI's regulatory powers or the sanctity of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court. This should help in consolidation in the power sector, possibly with the deep haircuts for banks. Granting any relief to particular sector would have led to pleas for exemption from other sectors too. So the government should display greater urgency in tackling systemic issues in different sectors, but there should be no deviation from the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court path because it has embarked on to fix the banking stress that has been creating a lot of problems to the Indian economy. Today's third topic is challenges at BIMSTEC. Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multisectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation Summit is going to be held in Kathmandu this week. Our Prime Minister Modi will attend this summit. This will be another great milestone for India after the BRICS BIMSTEC Outreach Summit that has been hosted by India in 2016. This BIMSTEC grouping has been gradually emerging as a key vehicle to take forward India's interest in every aspects like regional interest, strategic interest and economic interest. Why we have to give importance to BIMSTEC is because SAARC is not functioning properly because there is no proper cooperation from Pakistan. So we have to give importance to BIMSTEC and we have to reach all the nations that are part of BIMSTEC. We are not completely ignoring SAARC. We have taken every opportunity. We have taken all the necessary steps to deal with SAARC and deal with Pakistan in order to make this particular grouping relevant and functioning. But Pakistan is not cooperating well. Let's see two failed attempts of India with respect to SAARC. At the 18th SAARC summit that has been held in Kathmandu in 2014, India proposed SAARC Motor Vehicles Agreement, but Pakistan did not cooperate. This compelled Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal to go for Bibin Motor Vehicles Agreement in 2015. The same summit, our Prime Minister proclaimed that regional integration in South Asia would go ahead through SAARC or outside it, among all of us or some of us, keeping the doors open for those outside to join when they felt comfortable to do so. India also proposed its ambitious SAARC satellite project in which Pakistan opted out. Again, it's a failed attempt. So India giving importance to BIMSTEC is not to isolate Pakistan but to position BIMSTEC as an alternative to SAARC. So now you are clear that the main motivation for India to push BIMSTEC is not to isolate Pakistan, rather it is the country's interest, it is India's interest to ensure that the region does not lag behind just because one neighbor is not cooperating. India's desire to link South Asia with Southeast Asia is also part of this strategy. The rationale behind making the BIMSTEC mechanism work is to reassure South Asia that the region can work together to achieve common goals with India playing its due role. But there are challenges waiting for India at the BIMSTEC. What are they? India is currently the largest contributor to the BIMSTEC secretariat budget, that is 32%. Now the BIMSTEC Secretariat planning to strengthen its capacity, wanted to improve its capacity. So India may have to consider allocating more resources to the BIMSTEC Secretariat. So India's generosity would be the key test for its commitment to the sub-regional grouping called BIMSTEC. There is an impression that India is dominating BIMSTEC grouping. The same criticism India faced in SAARC also. So India has to deal with this issue. If we see in SAARC, the suspicion was mutual. That is, India is seeing other smaller countries that those smaller countries are cooperating with each other and acting against India. And those smaller neighbors were worried that the closer integration might lead to India's domination in the grouping. But today the scenario has changed. Most of the smaller countries wanted to engage with India in order to get economic benefits. But we cannot be sure that this perception will perpetuate. That is, for internal political reasons, the same issue may re-emerge and pose hurdles in the progress of BIMSTEC. That is, if elections were to be held in Nepal, Bangladesh, political parties may talk about India's domination in order to tap their vote bank. To moderate such suspicion, India will need to show sensitivity towards the concerns raised by smaller countries. China wants to be part of SAARC. Some members of the SAARC have their own interest in mind and they wanted to bring China in the grouping in order to balance India's dominance. China has already observer status in SAARC. When this was given, it only increased the demand to make China a full member of SAARC. Having emerging regional geopolitics in mind, India will have to play its role properly with respect to BIMSTEC. Otherwise, the reasons that led to defunct of SAARC may repeat with respect to BIMSTEC also. Today's final topic is the People's Campaign to Rebuild Kerala. We know that Kerala in recent times witnessed a heavy, unprecedented loss due to floods. The material loss estimated at around 26,000 crore. But beyond this, there has been immense loss to natural capital, human capital and social capital. Short-sighted attempts in building man-made capital like buildings in hilly forest and encroachments on wetlands and rivers, stone quarries, all led to this loss. We ignored the degradation of natural capital, human capital and social capital. Because of our ignorance, this problem got aggravated. So the immediate task in the state is relief and rehabilitation. Yes, but we also need to understand what caused this problem. We have to understand the root causes behind this big loss. The root causes prevail throughout the Western Ghats and the rest of the country also. The first reason is flouting of laws. Laws are enacted in order to safeguard natural capital. But we do not respect laws and we do not adhere to the laws, so we are facing the problem. The Shaw Commission inquiring into the illegal mining in Goa observes that mining beyond the limit has caused a serious damage to drinking water and agriculture and biodiversity. Coca-Cola factory that has been located in Prachmada Panchayat in Palakkad district has been overusing and polluting water resources. This has resulted in the losses to the tune of 160 crore. The third reason is we are continuously disregarding the scientific knowledge and advice that has been given by experts. In the case of proposed Attirappally hydroelectric project, an analysis conducted by Rivers Research Center showed that the project document had seriously overestimated the availability of water. The data examined showed that the likely power production in no way justified the cost of construction and running of the project. And fourth reason is there has been serious erosion of social capital. For instance, anti-quarry activist engaging in peaceful demonstration was killed. We cannot keep focusing on man-made capital alone. We must enhance that the sum total of man-made capital, natural capital, human capital, social capital. We must acknowledge that it is the local communities that have a genuine stake in the health of their ecosystems and understanding of the working of the same. Because people are living in that particular region, they will have more knowledge about the ecosystem. So we must allow them to function and we must cooperate with them whenever we take developmental projects. The current system of protecting natural resources through negative incentives in the hands of coercive and corrupt bureaucracy. Instead, they must give way to positive incentives that can be monitored in a transparent manner by all concerned citizens. Our Western Ghats panel proposes several such incentives. For example, payment of conservation service charges for protecting important elements of biodiversity such as sacred groves and payment towards soil carbon enrichment by switching to organic farming. That is, people living in the region protecting forests. So they have to be given some incentives so that they don't spoil the environment and the ecosystem is protected. So ultimately, the earth is benefited. Respecting the right of local communities to decide what kind of development they want, what kind of conservation measures they would like to see, how to be put in place. And government have to strictly implement 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment in letter and spirit. It must empower local bodies to decide how a substantial portion on the budget should be spent on the basis of these reports. Those local bodies must be given powers to levy collection of charges for access to biodiversity as well as intellectual property relating to community knowledge. In previous article, we have talked about environmental impact assessment. Here, biodiversity management committees should be given central place in the preparation of environmental impact assessment so that the true state of affairs will be known to government and the Ministry of Environment. And Forest Rights Act should be fully implemented in order to empower not only tribals but also traditional forest dwellers in order to control, manage and market non-timber forest produce so that they are economically empowered. Right to Information Act should be implemented in letter and spirit. We cannot suppress all environment and developmental related information, and we have to begin uploading the information so that people will know what is happening with respect to conservation of forest. Equipped with this information, all pertinent documents, the state government should ask local bodies about the level of ecological sensitivity in different parts of landscape on the basis of topography, hydrology, land use and vegetation regardless of ownership of the land. This is because people living in the region will know more about their topography, they will know more about their hydrology and how to use the land, and they will know what is the vegetation pattern there. So people's participation and people's suggestion should be given importance whenever you deal with conservation of forests and deal with land use. This will be a broad-based inclusive approach in order to conserve forests, in order to have an all-round development. Thank you.